Welcome back. We were discussing Scala control structures. The last item among the control abstraction is the for expression. The Scala's for loop is a Swiss Army knife of iterations. Here is the general structure of the for expression. It looks simple, but I realize that it is quite confusing to explain this structure. Let me take a progressive approach to explain this. To simplify the structure, let's remove the yield for now. The yield is optional. You will be using it most of the time, but let's keep it aside for the moment. Now, the structure looks like this. Let's try to understand it. If you learned other languages, this structure should look familiar, right? The things inside this parenthesis will control the number of iterations. And these curly braces represent the body of the loop. That's how it is in most of the languages. You can have one or more expressions within the body. If you have a single expression, curly braces are optional, right? We don't have any complexity for the body of the loop. It is almost same as in any other language. But this one here, the SEQ, sequence. This guy is somewhat complicated. It keeps confusing a lot of people. We will start with the simplest form and then expand it step by step. The simplest form of sequence is a generator that looks something like this. The call is a Scala's collection and E is a value that binds to each element of the collection. Let's take an example. So, N is a range collection with 10 elements. Now, I can iterate through this collection using a for loop. Simple, isn't it? You can remove this middleman and get a collection on the fly, like this. So far, so good. But one thing to notice here is this. You will need a collection to iterate using a Scala for loop. A beginner takes a lot of time to realize the fact that you need a collection to use a Scala for expression. If you don't have a collection, you can't use a Scala for loop. We wrote 1 to 5 here. It gives you a feeling that you are iterating 5 times. But in fact, you are iterating over a range collection. The range collection is implicit, right? Okay, let's move further. The body of the for loop in this example is quite simple. Just a println. Let's add some more code to it. This one is better, right? This one is an example of the most basic form of the for loop. Iterate over a collection and do something with each element of the collection. Now it's time for a quiz. And here is my question. Given this list, can you generate the same output without using a for loop? All you need to do is to print the capital of the country in the list, right? You already know it. I explained that in an earlier video. Pause the video and try it. Here is the code. Looks familiar? We learned it already in an earlier video. The for each method is a higher order control abstraction. The sole purpose of the for each method is to iterate over each element of the collection and apply the given code. We are doing the same thing in this for loop. Another question. Why do we have two constructs for the same thing? The answer is straightforward. The for loop is just a syntactic sugar for higher order control abstractions. Internally, both are same. What does it mean? That means the Scala compiler will convert the for loop to a combination of following control abstractions. In other words, Scala doesn't have a for loop. It's just a syntactic sugar for a set of these methods. So, if you don't like the for loop, you can manage to code in Scala without even worrying about the for loops. The real purpose of the Scala for expression is to write the code in a way that makes more sense. You should use the for expression when you think your code is getting too cryptic using those methods, and it would make more sense if you implement it using a for expression. Good. Once you know that the for expression is just a syntactic sugar, it becomes quite easy to understand the for expression. Now, let's bring the yield back into the structure. In the absence of yield, the for loop behaves like a for each method. When we apply the yield, it behaves like a map method. I hope you still remember the difference between for each and a map method. The for each returns a unit, whereas the map method returns a new collection. So, can you update this example to behave like a map method? I mean, return a new collection. You can pause the video and try it yourself. To achieve that, we need to make two changes. Place the yield just before the body of the loop. Remove these println and return the string. Simple, isn't it? Your for loop becomes a for expression. Now it returns a value. You can also assign the result of this for expression to a value. So far, so good. Now we need to get into the further expansion of the sequence. I said that the most simple form of SEQ is a generator that looks something like this. Scala allows you to have multiple generators. But the next generator will cause a nested loop. Let's see an example. So, for each value of I, you are getting two values of j, right? That's what the nested loop is. You can extend the nesting further. If the code between the pair of parentheses is getting complex, you can use curly braces. Now, the semicolon is optional. You can remove that. For each generator, you can apply filters. Let me show you. Let me apply a filter on the middle one. I am putting a filter to eliminate odd numbers. Only those elements will pass through that qualify this condition. You can also write it like this, one expression on each line. Let's take a better example to understand the power and flexibility of the for loop. I have this file. It contains the list of employees. Let's create a for loop to print all the records. Simple, isn't it? But I am not interested in all of these fields. I just want to see ID, first name, last name, and the department ID. Can we print only these fields? Let's do it. So, we split the line over a comma. Take only four fields. We did that in the body of the for loop. The for loop also allows you to embed assignment as part of the generator. Same as we embed a filter for the generator. So, the code should look like this. The idea is to expand the for comprehension instead of expanding the body of the for loop. Keep the body as simple as possible. Let me ask you a question. I am only interested in this department. Can you filter out others? Here is the code. So, it is not necessary to apply a filter before you apply an assignment. You have all the freedom. The example looks like an SQL query, isn't it? Can you extend this one further? Instead of showing the department ID, can we get the department name? So, basically, I want to see all the employees with their department ID replaced with their department names. You have a separate file for departments. Does it look like another SQL query? Join these two files and get the department name. Here is the Scala code. We got a nested loop. This example may not be the best way to solve this problem, but I just wanted to show you the power and flexibility of the Scala for expression. Great! We started the discussion with this structure. Now you know that the SEQ may have three components. A generator, that means a collection, a filter, or a guard. That means the if condition. A definition. That is an assignment. The filter and the definition are optional. You can have it if you need it. If you want a nested loop, you can repeat the entire set of next level of iteration. That's it. In the next section, we will talk about object-oriented features of Scala. Thank you for watching Learning Journal. Keep learning and keep growing.